start.
Okay, so I was asked to give a brief review of the theory status of for fermion production.
Is the microphone it? Is probably the other way. It was reversed.
Okay, is it better? Okay, so I was asked to give a brief review of the theory status of for fermion production in the plus and minus colliders. And of course, that's a very important process class. It was investigated at lab 2 in the energy range from the W pair production threshold to up to about 207 GeV. And it has been used for an impressive set of precision tests of the standard model. First of all, for this process is already cross-section measurements are, in a sense, precision measurements because they test quantum field theory at a very high accuracy. Then especially the W pair production process has been used to measure the W boson mass and width. And several processes have been used to bound anomalous triple gauge boson couplings. So here's a, we see the cross sections measured at lab 2, and we see that actually here this is E plus E minus QQ bar production, so that's by definition for fermion production. Here we have the W pair production cross section rising at the W pair production threshold. And then here we have, and the decay of the Ws leads to four fermion signature. And similarly, here we have the Z pair production cross section, again leading to a four fermion signature. So obviously, this class will be important for any future electron positron collider. And as I already briefly mentioned, in addition to being of experimental interest, it's also been a driving force for the theory community to push methods of perturbative quantum field theory. So first of all, already a consistent and gauge invariant definition of signals like W pair production is not trivial. This is related to the fact that we need to be able to treat finite width effects consistently. We have processes with different scales, many Feynman diagrams, and all of this complicates the theoretical description. So prospects at future colliders. So we have the obviously the FCC-EE projected to start running at the Z boson pole up to perhaps 400 GeV, an ILC which also might start at the at the Z resonance up to 500 GeV or possibly to up to 800 or 1 TeV in an extension, then click which might go up to 3 TeV. And the goals at these future colliders are, for instance, to measure the W boson mass more precisely than possible at hadron colliders, possibly down to 3 MeV at an ILC or below 1 MeV at a circular machine. Also, the precision of the effective weak mixing angle could be much improved, and also the triple gauge boson couplings. I must say that here I couldn't find a projection from FCC-EE, so maybe someone could point me to reference, or maybe that's just future work to be done to estimate the reach there. So obviously, for all of these, for understanding for fermion production will be very important. So, so for this talk, I was asked to give an overview of the Lab 2 experience, so that I didn't live through this personally, so I had to look into some resources. So the recommended source for the theory status is this report by Grünewald et al., and then the experimental analysis finally appeared 2 years ago on the archive. And then for the FCC-EE work, there is this web page of the relevant working group. So in this talk, after giving overview of the signatures considered in Lab 2, I will discuss some theoretical issues arising in the description of for fermion production, and then compare the experimental lab results to the theory status. And after that, I will outline what happened on the theory side after Lab 2, before I then will give an outlook on what might be possible in the foreseeable future to improve the theoretical description. So coming to the different process classes, these are the signatures that have been considered in this experimental lab analysis. So first of all, we have W pair production, or charged current for fermion production, which is obviously very important for the W mass and width measurements, branching ratios, testing, for instance, lepton universality, and anomalous couplings measurements. Then the related class of Z-pair production, which is mainly used for the cross-section measurement. Z-gamma production, also useful to measure anomalous vector boson couplings. And then, apart from this pair production processes, also more theoretically more complicated class are here single production cross-sections. So for instance, we can radiate a W of the positron beam and a photon of the electron beam, and they can collide to produce a S-channel resonant W boson. So that's called single W production, and the signature here is an electron and a neutrino missing energy and the decay products of the W boson. And then similar, there are also single Z boson processes where the Z is radiated off an electron, say, in Barber scattering. In reality, the W and Z boson are, of course, unstable, so this is what leads to this four fermion signature. But that leads to some complications on the theory side, because we really need to consider the process E plus E minus goes to four fermions as a signal. So then if we talk about W pair production, we don't just have the three diagrams, so-called charged current three process contributing to the resonant W pair production, but with the same signature, there are in total 10 diagrams where, for instance, the W boson is radiated from the final state leptons here in this example. And theoretically, already at tree level, only the sum of all these diagrams makes sense if you talk about the four fermion signature. If we consider electrons here, it's even more complicated. Then we have a totally different class of processes, but of diagrams, but these can be at least separated in a gauge invariant way. And this is kind of the showcase for the importance to treat finite width effects consistently. So this is here comparing two different widths, this running width scheme that Todd Riemann already mentioned. If you use this in such a complicated process, and at high energies, you can get results that are completely off what you get using a constant width, which is, in this case, more consistent. So this just shows that it's important to have this under control if we talk about high precision measurements already at lower energies. And for this reason, there has been an extensive study of several approaches for the treatment of finite width effects. This is documented in this report by Grünewald et al. Don't aim at giving a complete overview here, so apologies for every approach that I do not mention here. The details you can find in this report. And I somehow classify them roughly into three different philosophies. So one philosophy is that you have your machinery to do standard perturbation theory at leading order and NLO, and you want as little modifications to that as possible. And the simplest thing to do here is just to replace the mass in every propagator by this complex mass value, including the decay width. So this is some Bright-Wigner prescription. And in an electroweak theory that violates the weak gauge invariance if you do this to the W and Z bosons. But numerically, in most cases, at leading order, it's still it doesn't give rise to large numerical effects. Then there are more complicated versions of this with running width and so on, but this usually leads to more serious gauge invariance problems. Then the next philosophy, this was mentioned by Todd Riemann already, is the idea that if you want to describe a process with a resonance structure, then you make use of this resulting hierarchy differing resonant and non-resonant processes, and the ordering parameter is the ratio of the decay width over the mass. And then it's possible to expand your amplitude around the complex pole if you talk about a single resonance, then in the center of mass energy. So that's again this m squared minus I m gamma. Also, as already mentioned, that's a gauge invariant quantity. So then if one writes the amplitude near the resonance as this resonant term and a non-resonant term, then since the whole amplitude must be gauge invariant, then we can argue that this mu squared, so the complex pole, and the residue are gauge invariant, then by definition the remainder, the non-resonant remainder, also must be gauge invariant. So this has been also worked out for pair production, but I don't want to go into the details here. And then the third philosophy is to modify perturbation theory using gauge invariance as a guideline, so insisting maintaining strict gauge invariance, but still be able to resum some parts of the gauge boson self energies in the propagator. And this was done at lab times in the so-called fermion loop scheme, where one considers at one loop level all diagrams for the closed fermion loop. So this includes the gauge boson self energies and the vertex corrections. And then it was shown that it's consistent to sum up those fermion bubbles in the propagator. Obviously, this misses bosonic loop corrections, which become important for the precision one aims at for W pair production already at lab two. The mature version of this pole scheme for pair production is the so-called double pole approximation. And in this framework, there are two classes of corrections that arise. The first one are the so-called factorizable corrections, which are the, include the analog correction to the on-shell production of W pairs and the decay of W bosons. And then there's the so-called non-factorizable corrections, which connect the different stages of the production of the W pairs, initial final states and final state fermions. And near resonance, here only the soft photon corrections contribute. And this approach has been implemented in the Monte Carlo programs used at lab two for the analysis of the W pair production cross section, so Raccoon WW and YFS WW. In general, one can estimate the accuracy of this double pole approximation by, since we perform an expansion in this ratio gamma over M and do analog corrections. So at NLO, this should have an accuracy of this ratio gamma over M times alpha over pi, which if you include some safety factors is of the order of per mil. However, one can argue that near the production threshold, one loses accuracy. So this MW is replaced by the difference of the center of mass energy to threshold. So then if you're close to threshold, this degrades to the 1% accuracy, which is not accurate enough definitely for future E plus E minus colliners. Okay, so now we'll compare these different predictions to, or the experimentalists have compared for me, the accuracy of these different predictions compared to the experimental results. So for W pair production, that's the most precisely measured for fermion process at lab. There's a 1% level agreement, so the 1% is the experimental error with this analog theory in the double pole approximation I just sketched. And the residual theory uncertainty has been estimated to be around 0.5%. Now the question is, if we raise the luminosity by a factor of 10 to the 4, is it realistic on the theory side to get a theory uncertainty much less than a 0.1%? That's the challenge for the future here. Then going to Z pair production, here the NLO theory hasn't been pushed that far, so the pole approximation has been used just for QED, not for the whole electric sector of the standard model, and this fermion loop scheme I've mentioned has been used. Here the theory uncertainty has been estimated at around 2%, which was still good enough to cover the experimental uncertainty band here. So here the challenge will be to go down to the 1% level, given what has been estimated for the FCCE accuracy. Then we have the single resonant processes. Here we'll mention only the single W production. Here again, the fermion loop scheme and ISR and maybe otherwise improved Born approximations have been used to compare to the experiment. The residual theory uncertainty has been here estimated to be around 5%, but still it was good enough for the lab accuracy. So I should say here there are some more theoretical challenges because the experimental signature to identify this process is when this electron here is forward scattered, so with a very small angle to the beam axis. And that means that here there are collinear singularities, so one is sensitive to the, so needs the finite electron mass as a regulator, so this must be kept in the calculation, which makes it more complicated. And also here, this is the class of processes where potential violations of gauge generance can be blown up. So here it's especially essential to respect gauge invariance. Again, so the question is, will one be able to match a possible FCCE accuracy of about 1%? Okay, so this was the status of the lab experiment and the comparison to the theory available for this analysis. So now several things have happened on the theory side after lab 2. So first of all, the complete next leading order calculations not in a double pole approximation or so, but the complete electroweak corrections for the charged current for fermion production processes have been computed by Ansgar Denner and collaborators. And then going beyond next leading order, so now for the on-shell W pair production processes, logarithmically enhanced, Sudakov logarithmic enhanced corrections for a very large center of mass energy have been computed. So this will be relevant for, let's say, click or a high energy ILC. For the ILC running near the W pair production threshold, or in particular for the FCCEE, we have performed a threshold expansion as an alternative to this complete NLO calculation, and there also we have included leading next to leading order corrections. So that's important for W mass measurement from the threshold scan. I should mention that leaving this class of for fermion production, there have been other NLO electroweak corrections that have been calculated for vector boson production at linear colliders, at E plus E minus colliders. So the NLO EV corrections to the triple gauge boson production processes are also available by now. Okay, so let me discuss briefly this full NLO calculation. So if we not just look at this CC3 topology of W resonant diagrams, we get many more diagrams, also just including a single W at loop level, and here there are also 5 and 6 point functions that appear, and it was a breakthrough that to have numerically stable methods for these kind of diagrams, and this was first achieved here in this calculation for fermion production at E plus E minus colliders. And this calculation uses the so-called complex mass scheme, where one does this replacement of the vector boson masses by this complex pole of the propagator, not just in the propagators, but everywhere in the Feynman rule. So that means also to replace the weak mixing angle in this scheme by a complex number. But this is necessary to ensure gauge invariance. And then the authors have compared the result of this full calculation to the double pole approximation, and one sees that in this region where the double pole approximation was estimated to be accurate at the, let's say, 0.5% level, this actually works out. So if you're starting from, say, 100 GeV to 500 GeV, the double pole approximation works very well. If you go near threshold, as I mentioned before, the accuracy degrades. So here one should use this either this full for fermion calculation or dedicated threshold expansion. And then also if you go above 500 GeV here, due to the Sudakov logarithms I mentioned, then the double pole approximation is not accurate enough anymore. So that's, again, relevant for something like Click. Okay, so then, as I mentioned, the W pair production threshold is especially relevant or interesting in order to measure the W boson mass. So if one divides the cross-section at some value of a reference W mass plus some mass shift over the value at this nominal W boson mass, one sees that here in the threshold region, 1% difference in the cross-section corresponds to something like 15 MeV W boson mass shift. So one really needs a very precise prediction for the cross-section, but then one should be able to extract the W boson mass from a comparison of the cross-section measured at several points to the theory prediction. And we see here that it's not just an ISR improvement or so, which would bring you from the blue curve to the red curve, but to get to such a precision, here definitely at least the next leading order corrections which lead to the black curve would be relevant. So here we have, in addition to this four fermion calculation, performed a calculation using the threshold expansion. So we consider the velocities of the W bosons, which is called beta here, as an expansion parameter. And then there are important corrections which are given by logarithms of this velocity and Coulomb corrections which go like 1 over this velocity. And then in this, one can use an effective field theory approach where one expands simultaneously in the electromagnetic coupling constant, which is assumed to be, or which is of similar order as the ratio of the W decay width over the mass. And this again is counted to be of a similar magnitude as this velocity beta. And then in a, on top of the next leading order corrections in this approach, one can compute the leading and analog corrections, which all involve an enhancement due to this Coulomb correction, which goes like an inverse velocity. So we have then the two-loop Coulomb correction, which is known for a long time, but also, let's say, one-loop corrections enhanced in addition by a Coulomb correction. So here, this would be an example for a real photon correction and a virtual Coulomb correction. Then we have, let's say, hard weak corrections to the production of the W bosons enhanced by a Coulomb photon, and corrections to the Coulomb photon exchange themselves here by a fermion bubble. The sum of all these leading and analog corrections is of the order of 0.5%, so that's of the order that's consistent with the uncertainty estimate of the analog calculation in the threshold region. And this should be sufficient in accuracy for the ILC, but not enough for the FCC-EE. Yeah. So what is possible for the future? So with the current technology, it should be possible to extend this calculation for the full four fermion production cross-sections from the charged current processes to all four fermion processes. Which should give you something like the, which should get you below the 1% level. Possibly this forward scattering in single production processes needs some extra care. But to quote the conclusion from a talk at the previous FCCE workshop, to really exploit the potential, one might need to go to NNLO in the electroweak coupling for most processes. So what's the status at the NNLO front? So if one talks really about the complete NNLO calculation, we have, since very recently, the NNLO QCD corrections for vector boson pair production, on-shell vector boson pair production at hadron colliders, which is, however, simpler than the NNLO electroweak corrections because fewer mass scales that are involved and there are no problems with complex masses and so on. On the electroweak side, we have the two-loop electroweak corrections to a 1-to-2 process, Higgs to photon-photon decay. But so what's the gap remains to have a two-loop calculation to at least for a 2-to-2 process, which is more complicated than either of those two, but might be doable in some years' time from now. On the other hand, something like the extension of this E plus E minus 2 for fermion calculation to the full NNLO level is completely out of reach, or we don't have any idea how to do this right now. So to give you an idea, to go from NLO to NNLO for this class of processes of QCD corrections to on-shell vector boson production needed 20 years. So maybe since the NLO calculation for E plus E minus 2 for fermions was done 10 years ago, so maybe in 10 years we have an idea of how to do E plus E minus 2 to 4 fermions. That's as much as an outlook I dare to give here. So what seems to be more realistic is to extend this pole approximation or this effective field theory approach. For this, one would need as an input this calculation of E plus E minus 2 to vector bosons, to on-shell vector bosons, and also the NNLO corrections to the decay of the vector bosons. And then it should be possible to also do this double pole approximation, although the details of how to define the factorizable and non-factorizable corrections needs to, especially for the real corrections, needs to be worked out in this case still. For this effective field theory approach, in principle, such a calculation has been defined for inclusive observables like total cross sections. For single resonances, hasn't been done completely. So it will be a lot of work, but at least it appears to be feasible in principle to push this to the full NNLO. Okay, so this brings me to the summary. So for fermion production, cross sections processes are crucial at any future E plus E minus collider, including FCCEE, especially for the W mass measurement, either from a threshold scan or for, from direct reconstruction, for anomalous couplings measurements, and as I said, cross-section measurements here are itself an important precision comparison to the theory calculations. We have a full next leading order electroweak calculations for the charged current E plus or minus 2 for fermion processes with an estimate of an accuracy of a few 0.1% from threshold to around 500 GeV, near threshold and at higher energies leading NNLO corrections are available and should be included. A full NNLO electroweak calculation for on-shell vector boson pair production is beyond the current state of the art, but might be available in some years from now. And then one could use the pole approximation or the effective field theory formulation of that to include leading NNLO corrections on top. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. We have time for a couple of questions.
Just to get it right, this last point that you tried to make, in order to get to this, let's say, one MeV precision on the W boson mass from a threshold scan, we would need this NNLO electroweak for E plus or minus 2 VV or even so, 2-4 fermions. This would be needed.
I think so, yeah. So, I mean, it's hard to estimate the missing corrections, yeah, but so we see we have an 0.5% correction from the leading NNLO, so you want to make sure that you are down to the 0.1% level or something like this, so.
I think this is realistic, what you're saying, just.
Is there a way to monitor the correction by taking more than one point around 161 GV? Because is it the correction just a normalization effect or an effect on the slope? Because in the second case, one could do something with the data.
Yeah, no, let me go to here. So, no, it was later. So, I mean, we have estimated the effect of this various contributions we have calculated on the mass measurement, and there we really have used some points, I think, in whatever one GeV steps here. And yes, you see the sensitivity is different. So the cross section changes much more near the nominal threshold than above. So it's not just some overall normalization factor.
No. So one could use the data.
Even if you use several points, you need, I think, the full calculation, but still one could play with the distribution of the points to see how to minimize the theory uncertainty. We haven't done
that's this an interesting yet. Point, yeah. Mm. Okay, thanks. Let's turn the speaker again.